Harper Wave and Harper Audio present Fatal Conveniences, the toxic products and harmful habits that are making you sick and the simple changes that will save your health, by Darin Olien, read by Andrew Eiden. A note before we begin, you can download an accompanying PDF with product recommendations and recipes to make your own household and personal products from your audiobook provider, or go to www.harpercollins.com/pages/fatal conveniences. I dedicate this book to my late father, Howard Olien. He suffered from chemical sensitivities long before people knew such a thing even existed. Now, I'm passing the lessons he taught me on to you, in the hope that no one else will have to suffer. Introduction. I love conveniences. We all do, and for good reason. They make our lives so much better, easier. Without conveniences, life would be really hard. It would suck. Here's an example of a pretty amazing convenience we all enjoy: the wheel. Try to picture what life would be like if someone hadn't come up with the wheel way back whenever. Hard to imagine, but definitely a drag. Here's another great one: fire. Think of all the awesome things that happened once we managed to create and control fire and heat. We wouldn't recognize our lives without it. It goes way beyond just making things easier. I could spend all day naming wonderful conveniences: the internal combustion engine, electrical power, indoor plumbing, flight, agriculture, Wi-Fi. True, we could live without them, but life wouldn't be as much fun. This book is a convenience. Somebody, a team of us actually, had to research a long list of subjects and then organize the information and explain what it means and package it in a form that you could understand and easily use. What if everybody interested in this subject had to spend days and weeks wading through scientific literature, trying to make sense of it and then come up with advice on the best way to live? Not many people would do all that on their own. But we don't have to, thanks to our gift for conveniences. I was about to say it's human nature to find ways of making life easier and more efficient, but the truth is that all animals love conveniences. I just read about some cockatoos in Australia that figured out how to open garbage cans so they could eat what was inside. Some birds taught themselves the skill, while others watched until they learned to do it too. Still, other cockatoos just waited until everybody else finished eating, at which point they fed on the leftovers. A lot less work than scrounging for dinner old school. I live with two German shepherds, a 6-year-old named Chaga and a 4-year-old named Ella. They wouldn't even exist if 10,000 or so years ago some wolves hadn't discovered that if they hung around humans, they could eat their food scraps, which was a hell of a lot easier than chasing down prey and killing it. So it's obvious that all living creatures love conveniences and are excellent at inventing them. It's like a force of nature. It's who we are. It's a great thing. Until, of course, until we go too far and the conveniences we create start making us sick and killing us. Then they're not so great. They're not so great once they start causing cancers and other terrible diseases, or when they disrupt our ability to make babies, or when they trash our environment and hurt every living thing in the planet itself. Then conveniences aren't so cool. That's what I'm going to talk about in this book: the fatal conveniences that claim to help us but instead do us harm, even cause death, believe it or not. But don't worry, my mission is not to make your life more inconvenient or to scare you away from using the conveniences you love. It's to expose the ones that are damaging us and show that it's possible to find terrific products that are not fatal and are not harmful to ourselves and our world. That's our goal. And I have some amazing, wonderful things to tell you about along the way. Let's get going. 1. What is a fatal convenience? Let's start with a partial list, just so you know what's in store. Personal care products like soap and body wash, shampoo, fragrance, moisturizer and skin lotion, anti-aging creams, petroleum jelly, cosmetics, tampons, shaving cream, sunscreen, deodorant, toothpaste, mouthwash. Household items including laundry detergent, dryer sheets, furniture, carpeting, air conditioning, bedding, cleaning products, air fresheners, cookware, plastic containers, aluminum foil, plastic wrap. Electronic devices like microwave ovens, modems and Wi-Fi, computers and tablets, cell phones, Bluetooth headphones. Food and drink, including snack foods, non-organic produce, conventionally raised meat and poultry, nutritional supplements, energy drinks, dairy products, bottled water and other beverages. And some random things you might never suspect, such as jeans, dental floss, dry cleaning chemicals, diapers, fast food wrappers, t-shirts. This includes a lot of stuff we all use every day, right? The list of fatal conveniences is almost endless, and it constantly grows longer as new products and novel substances are introduced into the marketplace and our homes and lives. There are so many more, but this is a good start on the major ones. Over the past 50 or so years, more than 80,000 chemicals have been introduced into our environment, and the vast majority weren't tested first to see if they were safe for human contact. We know for a fact that at least 1,500 of them are suspected of being carcinogenic. Many times, more often than not, we don't even know that these substances are contained in the things we use every day. How insane is that? We're buying them, eating them, putting them onto our skin, bringing them into our homes. But what exactly are they? Most of the time, we have no idea. In lots of cases, the damage isn't even created by the convenience itself. It's caused by a hidden, unnoticed ingredient that comes along for the ride. The preservative, the propellant, the flavoring, the dye, the emulsifier, the thickener, the lining of the container, the completely unnecessary fragrance that's there only to make you love the product a little more. The carcinogenic pesticide used in farming that's a shortcut for the big agriculture conglomerates. The sugar under an unrecognizable name. The harm that is done is often like the shadow of the thing, the aura, the invisible residue that it leaves behind. It's extra dangerous because we don't even know it's there. Want a good example? You are probably unaware that a chemical from the same family as Teflon is used on clothing so that it won't be wrinkled after you wash it. Cool, great idea. The only problem is that the chemical sometimes causes skin irritation, can disrupt your normal hormone function, and may even be cancer-causing. So there's the trade-off that can be found at the heart of all fatal conveniences. On the one hand, no more ironing. On the other, increased risk of cancer. Worth it? Here's another. Early in the 20th century, scientists discovered that areas with high levels of naturally occurring fluoride in their drinking water also had low levels of tooth decay. Before long, communities across the U.S. were adding the chemical to their tap water, and soon after, manufacturers began putting it into toothpaste. A wonderful convenience. And then researchers learned some alarming facts about fluoride, mainly its toxic effects on the developing human brain. Children in high fluoride areas had significantly lower IQ scores than those who lived in low fluoride areas, according to one study. There were also some concerns about fluoride consumption and its relationship to bone cancer, bone fractures, and reproductive system problems. To be fair, fluoride is a problem only if you swallow it, but try telling that to kids happily using bubblegum-flavored toothpaste. So you decide, is a mouth of cavity-free teeth worth a couple of IQ points? Or maybe the kidney beans in that can are nutritious, but the lining of the can? Toxic. Or your new stretch jeans fit and look great, but they're shedding tiny bits of microplastic that go into your body and your environment. Wouldn't you rather get your beans and your jeans without anything gnarly on the side? That's the kind of thing I'm going to be talking about. There's a lot to say. I want to walk you through a day in the life of fatal conveniences. Let's begin with something really basic but really important. How you smell. How we all smell. Throughout this book, as you'll see, the subject of fragrance comes up again and again. It's one of the biggest culprits in the world of fatal conveniences, especially when we're talking about personal care products, a very big deal in most of our lives. We're all suckers for a pretty smell. The olfactory system is overwhelmingly powerful, the strongest of all our senses by far. You can smell something today, and not again for the next couple decades, but when you're exposed to it then, you will recognize it. Can't say the same about something you saw, heard, or felt. There's a good reason our noses are so strong. We use our olfactory sense to tell us what is safe to eat. It's why our noses are right over our mouths. In the wild, it's also good for knowing if a predator, or prey, is nearby. Smell and survival go hand in hand. What's so bad about smelling good? Fragrance holds a special place in the world of fatal conveniences due to a 1966 federal law that regulates labeling and packaging of personal care products. In that law, there's something known as the fragrance loophole. It means that manufacturers don't have to list the ingredients used to give products their smell. Instead, they can just say fragrance or parfum on the label. That's because the way something smells is considered a trade secret, meaning that we're not allowed to know what we're putting on our bodies. As a result, your lotion, soap, or shaving cream can have any combination of the more than 3,000 chemicals used to give products their aroma, and you'll never know what exactly is in a given product or if it's hazardous to your health. According to Janet Noodleman, co-founder of the Campaign for Safe Cosmetics, a project of the Breast Cancer Fund, we found fragrance chemicals linked to cancer, birth defects, endocrine disruption, and other serious health conditions in everything from children's shampoo to body lotion to perfumes. One chemical sometimes found in fragrance, styrene, has been labeled a human carcinogen, and others can cause allergic reactions and irritation of the skin, eyes, and lungs. With all that in mind, let's start our day. We wake up and shower with soap or body wash. There's one fragrance. Shampoo, there's another. Conditioner, another. Our deodorant is a fourth. Our toothpaste and mouthwash, a fifth and sixth. And if we're using skin lotion or moisturizer, we're up to 7 different smells. If you're a woman who's been deceived into thinking you need a vaginal deodorant, that's number 8. Using some kind of hair product? Now we're up to 9 fragrances synthesized in industrial labs, and we still haven't put on the perfume or cologne that we intend for the world to inhale whenever we walk into a room. That's number 10. Now let's get dressed, meaning we'll add in the aroma of our laundry detergent, and maybe our dryer sheet or fabric softener too. That's 11 and 12. Almost forgot, currently something called an in-wash scent booster is popular, just in case our clothing needs to smell even better than we do. That's more than 12 different chemical smells. Which one is us? None of the above. What do we smell like? Who knows? Maybe we smell great without all that stuff, but as long as we keep using it, we'll never know. I get it. We'd all like our hair to smell like a tropical rainforest, even though not many of us know what a tropical rainforest actually smells like. And who doesn't want armpits that remind them of a field of wild lavender in the south of France? But come on, we're exposing ourselves to who knows what dangers just so we can smell like something we're not. Is that worth risking our health? Now we're at home, another amazing convenience. It protects us from the harsh elements. It contains all the things we want and need to live, including all our other conveniences. It's the place we gather, where we can hang out for hours on end, sleep, make love, or do anything else we want. It's our castle. Once upon a time, it was just a cave or a hut, but we've come a long way since then, and everything about our homes has only gotten better. No wonder we love being there. But of course, as I've already said, every convenience comes with a price tag, whether we see it or not. How is your house bad for your health? For one thing, our bodies and minds benefit from being outdoors in the open air, soaking up sunlight, in nature, because we're nature. And when we're outdoors, it's likely that we're moving around, and being in motion is another thing we need on a daily basis. Instead, we live more than 90% of our lives inside. Indoors, we spend too much time sitting in chairs, hunched over computers, earning a living, meaning we're also courting back pain, neck pain, postural strain. When we had to hunt, gather, or grow our daily sustenance, we spent most of our waking hours outside. Inside was where we went once the sun set, and since there was no electricity for lamps, TVs, or video games, and we were exhausted anyway, we went to sleep. Our waking and sleeping were dictated by the planet's rotation around the sun, our circadian sleep rhythms, and our biological clocks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.